First of all, I would like to thank very much Peter and Karima for this invitation, enabling me to share ideas with a prominent specialist of urban data. I took the opportunity of the title they suggested me to go back in time with a state of data regarding the geographical coordinates, so geographical information of that time. And here is a map of the beginning of the 16th century made in an obscure monastery in Saint-Dié-des-Vosges by a man called Waldsee Müller. And this map, interestingly enough, shows for the first time the location of America and named America according to an error, because of course this discovery afterwards is imputed to Christophe Colomb. But at that time, the information about geographical information was secret. It was a source of money that could be extracted from different countries, other resources and trade routes. And that's how the name of America Vespucci was conveyed to the technics is not yet so advanced and friendly to humans. Thank you. But humans are very friendly. Well, and this story is enumerated in a book by Stefan Zweig explaining why the name of Amerigo Vespucci, who was an Italian and closer to the road through the Rhine in proximity of Saint-Dié-des-Vosges, was conveyed at first and escamotating the role that Christophe Colomb played in the discovery. Well, this state of information referred to a time where this basic geographical coordinates and related information were hidden, but also used to manage conflicts between the territories. And a famous Chinese treaty about the art of war also recall what Yves Lacoste used to say, la géographie, ça sert d'abord à faire la guerre, which perhaps we don't like so much. So nowadays the picture is so different. We have mentioned all those marvelous tools with provided, for instance, by Google Maps, Google Earth, for informing about the classical geographic information, basic coordinates. There is even a participation of people in operations like OpenStreetMap and my good child, speaking about volunteer geography, mentions that, this democratization of geographical information. And we find it now everywhere, especially in all the geo applications that we have in our mobile device. So we now have open data on that information, but has geopolitics disappeared? On the contrary, as Laurie just before mentioned, we have an important driving force in the dynamics of urban systems, which is the classical, traditional, multiplied rivalry between different cities. And this state of facts was already analyzed by a man of the Renaissance, so a little time after the Amerigo Vespucci map. And because in a treaty annexed to a big volume on the region di Stato, the government of state, he mentioned in a small booklet his reflection about le cause de la grandezza e bellezza delle città. And in that book, indeed, you can find every detail that we further investigated to build an evolutionary theory of urban systems. They are all enunciated by related observations, not only to the rivalries of small state cities of Italy compared to the big Kingdom of France, for instance, but as well to the evolution of the newly founded colonies in South America. And the same processes were visible. So what I'm going to tell you now stems from reflections that were elaborated, especially during this geodiversity program, which officially was 5 years of investigation, but relying upon a long story of other investigation. It is a teamwork. It is interdisciplinary because we are geographers, but working with statisticians and computer scientists on a daily basis. And in that work, we look at, when I speak about cities, we consider entities that are evolving through space and time, meaning that we consider the urban agglomeration or functional urban areas, if you like, that are consistently defined at each period of observation. And so we have investigated and built a database for some 50,000 cities in different parts of the world, including all the BRICS, Brazil, former Soviet Union, China, India, and South Africa, as well as the United States and Europe. And observed mainly between 1950 and 2010, but sometimes over a longer period of time. And this was an interdisciplinary win-win cooperation because the computer scientists were able to build an open simulation platform, which is called OpenMOL, and using very efficient algorithm, genetic algorithm, and distributed computing. And using that was very, very fruitful for people from social sciences because for the first time, we were able to validate, really, a multi-agent system through some half a billion simulations of the same model, and being able to give an answer, are those hypotheses both necessary and sufficient? And I think this is indeed a big progress. So I want to address now the data that we don't see, that we cannot use because they are more or less hidden or because of lack of awareness very often. And everybody here knows that it is very difficult to find disaggregated data at the level of urban agglomerations or functional urban areas regarding the income, the generated product in this area. China is the only country providing for all of the districts composing the urban area information about fiscality, taxes, and income. We use proxies, we have seen many, but are they sustainable? The hamburger price has decreased as a value among urban data. And we have seen that despite the big data, it is a huge work for estimating the value of city in terms of power, aesthetics, heritage, environmental sustainability, which is very often too narrowly estimated, social cohesion, and even individual happiness, despite the surge emergence of so many indices, most often founded upon declarative affirmations. What I want to insist here is there is another category of urban data that are very often forgotten, which are the effects of networks, the organization of cities in systems of cities, interdependent and co-evolving, and what they get because of this implicit organization, which is not institutional, but it is most of time de facto organization, providing network returns. And I will show examples where, from our studies, we can affirm the existence of network returns due to the exploitation of differences and in size and function within connected, interconnected systems of cities, and also the propagation of information in a variety of communication networks. For instance, we have here a result of a simple result, easy to understand, of a complex model, simulation model, which was applied by Clémentine Cotineau to the some 1,000-1,500 cities of the former Soviet Union. And when she was able, in building step by step this model, to insert more and more processes, technical mechanism in the algorithm, and information about environmental conditions, which are sometimes necessary to simulate the trajectories of cities between on a period of 50 years. On the left-hand side, you have the comparison of the observed population in X and simulated population in Y. And so the red line would be exact similarity. You see that using a stochastic model of growth, the Gibrats model, what you get is a systematic underestimation of the population attained by city, most of cities at the end of the period. Whereas on the right-hand side, if you introduce, like in Marius' model, the second version, if you introduce interactions between cities, then you are able to generate an urban growth which is in better correspondence with the observation. So cities gain something from the fact being interconnected in a system of cities. And this, indeed, is got by exploiting the qualitative and quantitative differences among cities belonging to the same system. And here we have a schematic representation of what was already mentioned by Andrés Rodríguez-Pose and other speakers about the hierarchical diffusion of innovation in a system of cities, because each time you have a novelty appearing in the system, and which is usually a wave of connected innovations. In a first stage, they are implemented in the largest cities, which have the best level of skill of population, a huge financial possibility of investment in the novelty, which is very risky at that time, and many other infrastructures enabling the development of the novelties. In a second step, when the innovation is socially well adopted and start diffusing the invention, the associated innovation move to medium-sized cities where the rent and wages are at a cheaper level than in those big cities we were speaking about today morning. And in a third step, when the innovation becomes mature and is perhaps replaced by something different, we have usually a retraction in the small points in green here. But already at the same time, we have another, a second wave of innovation, which again is concentrated in the largest cities which are adopting it at first. That is the meaning of hierarchical diffusion. And the consequence can be observed directly by looking at scaling laws, scaling relationship between the size of cities and the quantity of attributes corresponding to either activities, establishments, firms, any indicator related to the new wave of innovation, which generates for the variables beta values above one, indicating a relative concentration in the largest urban areas. And when things are becoming commonplace, we have a proportionality between the quantities and the size of the cities. And when the products or employment concern mature activities, we have this retraction on the smaller town, which is translated into beta values below one. We also tried to implement models of the geographical urban dynamics in a very different period in history, because at the moment of emergence of cities, and it means several centuries between minus 8,000 and perhaps the Middle Age in Europe, for instance. Here we have entities which were not exactly isolated, but just starting, this is the definition of the emergence of cities, just starting establishing connections within a neighboring or perhaps more distant sometimes cities which were the location for different resources and innovation started propagating between them. Of course, at that time, the development of cities was very much constrained by the resources of their local environment, as well as by the many destructions that were intervening because of either natural catastrophes that couldn't be controlled, and very often by conflicts with neighboring or distant other cities. And until I think about 15th or 16th century, there were cases of complete destruction. Cities were erased, and sustainability was very difficult to maintain during those centuries. But anyway, during that time, systems of cities were progressively built, and sometimes in small entities like the city-states of Italy or Germany, and sometimes in looser, big empires like in Central Asia for a while, or sometimes in integrated territories like in China, for instance. There was a big diversity of system of cities in that period. Then arrives the Industrial Revolution, enabling regular communication, a decrease in transportation costs everywhere. And then at that time, we can speak of real city networks of cities. And there was a huge progress in not only in demography, but in economy at that time, probably due to this organization in networks and the accelerated diffusion of information about technology and economy occurring at that time. And when we simulate this type of system, we no longer care about the environmental constraint because the source of wealth of cities is coming from their interaction trade with all other cities they are very well connected with, and we have many examples of co-evolution of cities of different size inside territories of different size as well. And then we have a kind of a free urban dynamics which has generated so many progresses in economy and demography in the last two centuries only. And of course with delayed processes between developed countries and less developed countries, as Andrés Rodríguez-Pozo demonstrated today morning. And what will happen in the future according to this organization in system of cities? The evolution may be different because we have the possibilities of two possibilities for circulating information. We have in the system which is now again constrained by the lack of physical resources all over the planet, and with the necessity of starting this ecological transition, which is a condition for the next sustainability. So we have a possibility of top-down diffusion according to any hierarchical diffusion of innovation, of the hierarchical diffusion of any innovation. So top-down regulations arrive and are assimilated by cities, whereas as well, as we have seen many cases, many examples of local sourcing this morning, we have initiatives which appear locally, and because of this organization of cities in system of cities, can be disseminated all over the urban networks. And that's why we see sometimes small towns being so innovative and having such an unviable quality of life, and their example may be followed by many, many other cities in the system. So this, of course, we also can model, but I think that in this process of measuring the network added value of cities, we should think of all urban values, not only economic value, which usually are referred to as network economies, but think of all what can be shared in terms of cultural initiatives, in terms of good decision-making processes inside cities through these networks. So I'm sure that inspiration can be conveyed among a variety of co-evolving cities for ensuring better development and ecological transition. And moreover, what is very important to go against the propagation of fake news, the bad money chasing the good one, and all the threats that Laurie just before me made us aware of, I think that it is important to propagate quickly information about what is going right or wrong after such and such initiative, especially for reducing development gaps and inequalities among cities and inside cities as well. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much. Questions, please. We have time for about three questions or so, depending on the difficulty of the question.
No, thank you very much, Denise, for a very, very interesting presentation. I was wondering if you could elaborate a bit more on your final points, the role of networks and of information diffusion. How can that reduce inequalities? And would it not, in some circumstances, perhaps encourage greater inequalities?
Yes, a good question, and of course very difficult to solve in practice. But think about what Laurie said about asymmetries, and asymmetries of information are very important. I'm sure that any responsible mayor, as the mayor of Bosch we have seen today morning, is fully aware of its competitor and trying to make the best choice to situate his or her city in the good possible direction relatively to others. But this knowledge is not enough distributed in general population. People don't clearly have the possibility of measuring clearly what is their situation compared to what is happening in other cities and, moreover, in other countries. So I think that investigation worldwide, as the one you have done, are very useful to improve this asymmetry of information between not only scientists, but also people elaborating regulations. And regulations have to be each time adapted to the local situations, of course.
Time for one more question. It was all very clear to you, that's clear. I have a question for you, more a remark. In your chapter of Impressive Minds that you wrote, the economic not only space matters, but certainly also territory and politics. Is it that politicians should take more responsibility in that respect?
I don't know what is to be said to respond to people being responsible in politics, because it's so difficult. They have this kind of double bind, being between short-term decision to ensure re-election and longer-term decisions, which are often contradictory. But if they want to appear in history as having taken the right orientation, they should care. So it's a difficult equilibrium to find. And in concrete situation, as longer as they have the concern for public safety, public services, public, not only their own career, I think we should be confident in their decisions, because it is a very difficult profession.
It is, but it's also a public task, so they should think about the humans of the future. Demis Pumet, thank you very much.